Nope, Facebook, you guys are in luck because for some reason it didn't drop it, so that's good. So let's see if I could get the chat for, okay, that's Facebook. Let's do YouTube chat. Okay, so here we go. Okay, so now we can talk to YouTube, if anyone's out there on YouTube. Last week I was kind of discouraged. This time I'm just like not doing it anymore. That's it. Definitely, it is better for me to do those videos. So we're definitely going to do that. Once in a while I may do some live streams, but this is the last hurrah as far as regularly scheduled. If you're around when I'm doing it, that's good. If you're not, oh well. So if anyone is out there, just, I'm not going to talk until I know someone's out there. So I'll just draw and, hey, Wendy, how are you? Good to see you. Yeah, I had to, it was a friend's birthday, so I had got sidetracked with that. And then I posted on Facebook that I was going to start at 10 o'clock tonight. Does everything sound good? Does it sound okay, Wendy? So basically what I'm doing is I'm basically working out the drawing from an original projection, as you see here. So here's my projection, and so that's, and even though it's projected, it's really the sensitivity and the contours are all going to be worked out after the fact. Oh, thanks, Wendy. I appreciate that. So when you're working on the contours, you want to go down and up. You want to sort of meet together. Same here. You want to get that handwriting of the contours. Oh, thank you, Wendy. I appreciate it. This new location here is a little bit different. It has a new circumstance, a little further away from the router. So sometimes it feels like, you know, it is jumpy a little more. But right now I'm doing YouTube and Facebook at the same time. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Wendy. So that's basically, you know, where we're at. We're going to work out some of the drawing, not too much. Keep it light. And then we're going to go in with the India ink, which is three. I usually start with 3 drops of India ink and 3 full eyedroppers of this here. So 3 full of these and 3 drops. And that's usually the best dilution. It gives a nice mid-tone and you're able to correct mistakes, which is important in the early going. You want to work from light to dark, as always. But no fear, as we found out with Natalie Wood, we're actually able to go ahead and erase after we put down the airbrush with the India ink, which is great. Now here, if you notice, I don't like the way the contour is. I don't like the way this comes in and then this comes out. I just don't like it. And oh, cool, you're that's great, you're on Facebook and YouTube, very cool. And YouTube is sounding okay as well, Wendy? I think that's a little more of a graceful line, so that's why. And maybe I can change it a little bit. I like that a little bit better. Gives more emotion than having it the way the photograph has. So as long as it's anatomically correct and don't look like a mutant, it's okay. It's okay to go ahead and make some artistic license changes. We're not photographers, so we can do that. Now this is interesting. So right here is this shadow plane, sort of this cast shadow of her ear. And this is interesting. So we want to make sure we get this contour right. We don't want to start, "Hey, how you doing, Lisa?" And let's see who else is here. Lisa and Joe, thanks so much for stopping by, guys. And Johnny, hey, how you doing? So this paper is my favorite. It is Gunmetal by De La Rowney. This is a Canford cardstock. It's 8.5 by 11, and you can get that at Dick Blick. I think it's like $8-9 for a set of 10, which is great. So that's fantastic. So how you doing, Lisa? Good to see ya. So basically, for those just joining us, this is a projection. And with the projection, I am just, because it's going to be an airbrush. But what I want to do is I want to really work on the contours, make them beautiful, make them my own. And also, I want to make sure that I have things correctly, anatomically, and some of these details. I don't want to work that out with the airbrush. I want to work that out with the pencil, and the pencil is what I know best. So that definitely is the route I want to go with that. So that's cool. Very cool. It's good to see everybody today. So that's nice. And so we're working on this back area right here. So here is our cast shadow. And we want to make sure I don't make that cast shadow too thick. And then I see that. Now this is something that I even missed in the projection, which is good because that's where your drawing comes in. So right about here, it makes a turn. And this is good because if you're just using stencils, you're not going to really know or care about these subtleties. But I think catching these angles and everything and what's happening with her back and her neck is really going to help you understand when you start coming in with the airbrush. So Johnny, man, how you doing? And Lisa and everybody, Joe, Wendy, very cool. Good to see you guys. Happy Wednesday night, right? Okay. And so, very good. Okay, so you see, I'm just working on those contours, making sure that I'm setting up the airbrush. And that's what we're doing. So last week with Natalie Wood, we had a much lighter paper. And that one is right here. This paper, that's not the paper, but it's very similar to it. Let's see if I can find it. Actually, I'll be right over here. So this is the paper. This is De La Rowney, and it's called Dreadnought Gray. And that was good to use for the Natalie Wood. But as you can see, when you have a darker picture, this is probably much better. Let me see with a different camera. You see, this paper is much better this paper is much better for that than this. So sometimes it's good. The paper that you use definitely is dependent on your... The paper that you use is definitely dependent on the subject matter. Oh, cool. Yes, the summer is great. That's for sure. And it is busy, right? And let's see. Sometimes when I do a projection, I'll use white pastel. Just during the projection, just to gauge certain areas, such as the hair. And that would be the only way you can actually indicate them. Those are going to go away, but that's going to help me as to where I put the darker values and, you know, help me with the drawing. Sort of like sort of markers on a roadmap, right? So that really helps. So yeah, I definitely do that from time to time, not all the time, but once in a while. But yeah, Wendy just purchased a projector, and once she gets all the bugs out of it, it's really going to help her art a lot. And projecting is actually an art form in itself, so it's definitely you're definitely going to enjoy it. There'll be some of a learning curve. Just be patient with yourself. That's for sure. And I'm just going to go ahead and really work out this ear, because this ear is very interesting. Sometimes the glasses are better, but sometimes they just don't work. Depends on the lighting, really. And like I said, with this technique, I can actually go ahead and put as much graphite as I want. I just don't want to go too dark and that sort of thing. Oh, great. So I'm so glad that the Oprah projector is working again. That's a relief. That's good to hear, Wendy. And it's nice that the guy went and called you. That's great. And never trust your projection. It's just, like I said, for me, it's for proportions and placement of the composition. I end up drawing most of it anyway. There we go. So you see, I'm basically just mapping things out. But this is a very important thing, so rather than just do a speed drawing or impress everyone like how it comes out, definitely show you the, you know, the down and dirty part of a portrait and airbrush. So the sound is okay for everybody? Not too bad. And then we have this beautiful cast shadow here. And I always make sure that I don't take any of the contours, even something simple as the ear, granted. I really pay attention to what's happening. There we go. Okay, so that's about as far as I want to go with that. Oh, great. So thanks so much, guys. The sound is good. I appreciate that, Johnny. Thank you so much. Definitely, if it doesn't work, Wendy, send that projector back. But it sounds promising if you got it to work. So I'm taking note of a lot of lost and found edges here. That's very important. So here we have this edge of right there. Now, you definitely don't want to, thanks, Wendy. You definitely don't want to make stuff up. So you see right here, there's like hardly any edge. So I'm making a note with that by just very lightly showing that the edge is gonna, it's right here, then it sort of dissipates and kind of gets lost. Same thing here. There's this shape here, which is the shadow as her jaw sort of turns away from the light. So I'm just going to go ahead and indicate the shape of that light. That's for me, and that's for me to make that mental note when I am developing the three-dimensional form. Now we're getting a lot of, I'm seeing a lot of like it stops. Are you guys seeing that where sometimes we're working and then all of a sudden it stops? That's something I think that is, I'm far away from the router. I think that's what's causing that. And right now I'm gonna definitely work out. Let's go to this angle here. And what I'm doing is really working out all the details and the shape of her eye and the way the shadow, also the space between her eye and the white of the corner of her eye, which is very important. It's going to go a long way with giving this wonderful expression that she has. Still keeping everything very light. I can put down as much pastel I want because I can always erase the pastel after the India ink on this paper. Oh, okay, so it sort of blurs out sometimes when we get that hiccup with the internet connection. It's good because I can just get a hint of some of the anatomical landmarks that I'll be using when I go in to go in with the ink, which is good. And this way, just like with Natalie Wood, I have a real game plan, and I have everything mapped out as to, you know, how I want to go with this. See if I can change this angle even better. That's not bad. That's good. less of a hiccup with this here. I think something's going on maybe with the HDMI connection. That could happen. But I really think it is the internet. But there's always going to be, you know, hiccups. But as you can see, even with a projection, I've been projecting for years. You have to learn how to draw because you are going to miss a lot. You're going to miss a lot of things. Oh, I see. Yeah, that's a shame. I'm going to open the door. The cat's going to come in, but... that might help with the internet connection, because I do have that door shut. So maybe... I think it is actually helping, because now it looks like there is no lag so far. Look at that. The lag is gone. The lag is gone. Isn't that funny? And now the cat's in here. So she might be starring in this live feed. Yep, there she is somewhere. I hear her meowing. Really? That's interesting. Hey, Heath, how you doing, man? Good to see ya. Oh, everything's okay. Good to see you. Just dealing with the door getting in the way of the internet, and that is a cat, my cat, and she's right there. She's not missing her opportunity to come in and join the live stream. I'm still getting a little bit of lag, but far less since I opened the door. Uh-oh, we lost the feed. Oh, look at that. Okay, let's go ahead and see if I can get Facebook back. So YouTube guys, you still see everything. I mean, you're still here, right? So Facebook should be back. Let's see if I could. Now you're gonna hear, okay, cool. So I do see Facebook went away. And I mean, Facebook's still here, but we're still on with, now you guys out in YouTube, you guys still see me? Because it looks like XSplit Broadcaster just sort of... okay. Okay, so we'll start the broadcast again with Facebook. And Facebook, we're still back here, and we still have YouTube going, which is cool. So that's good. And as far as now, there's gonna be a little bit of, okay, so you still see me, Wendy, here on YouTube. Yeah, so it looks like the whole thing is freezing up on here. So Facebook Live was terminated. Okay, cool. Okay, so bear with me. I'm just trying to get back on Facebook. But as you can see right now, I'm just working out a lot of these. Now this is a very soft edge here, which is right here. So I want to make sure that I get the shape correct. And also, I might just give up on Facebook right now because it's really acting temperamental. I mean, it's freezing the computer and everything. But I think on YouTube you guys can still see me. So Facebook is out of luck today, so we'll stay with YouTube. So you guys out on YouTube, we're just gonna stick with you guys. Let's see. Okay, cool. So let's try one more time with Facebook. And okay, so let's see what happens with that as I just work on some of the contours of her eye here. And just like Natalie Wood, we definitely got plenty of time to get where we want to be. Yeah, Facebook is just not working, so we'll just call it a day with Facebook. Wow, so it must be something going on with the internet as a whole. I was having some problem last week, but nothing like today. And then over here, I want to work on this contour as well. Just little bits of hint of her hair, just a little bit, and what that does, it softens up that contour going up to her shoulder, I mean going up to her eye and her forehead. Now there is just a little indication here of her eye, very lightly, but I do like it, so I'm actually going to try and work that out. Hey Brian, you're seeing me on Facebook? Now that's crazy. Because according to this, I'm not on Facebook. So Brian, you see me on Facebook? Wendy, could you check? Hey Willie, how you doing? Because Brian's seeing me on Facebook. That is some weird wild stuff. That's unbelievable. Willie, it's good to see you guys. Hold on one moment for me. Kiva, how you doing? So you guys are seeing me on... That's crazy. You know why? Because according to my software, I am not on Facebook. That is crazy. Wow, that's unbelievable. I have never seen anything like that. Yeah, the internet is working crazy. But hey, if it's working, right guys? That's great. So, yeah, so we got Willie and Wendy and Kiva, Christian, let's see, we have Joe and Johnny and Lisa. So we have a pretty healthy group here, some from Facebook, some from YouTube. And it looks like we're still catching Facebook, which is wild, right? That's unbelievable. Yeah. The internet's working really weird, that's for sure. What I'm going to do is I'm going to purchase a extender of my router. And this way I'll get a really good connection where I have my YouTube studio. So that's going to help. Hey, what's happening, man? Jake, don't worry. It just started not too long ago. So you're actually on time. So that's good. Yeah, this is definitely the weirdest live stream ever because I am not hooked up to Facebook anymore. Wow, this is something. Hey, I'll take it, right? That's for sure. I kind of like this view today. It's pretty cool. So what I'm doing is I'm not gonna go too crazy. I just wanna make sure I get the shapes down, especially with her eye here. So her eye comes out right about here. And this is where it always pays to work on your drawing. Because even if you projected it, it's still something that you can't take for granted that the projection is going to go well. A lot of times you're going to have to draw it out anyway. See right here? So we're going to have to go in there. See this little shape here? This is going to be key. This shape looks sort of like a rhombus. So, sort of comes in like this. Actually, I see there's a bigger gap between the edge of her profile here. And then it's a little bit longer. So these are things. Oh, thanks. This is the best part of the DSLR and making it into a webcam. But you see that shape, guys? That is crucial. You got a little bit of glare there. I heard something really cool today, and I liked it. I think it was on one of Casey Neistat's videos where he said that done is better than perfect. And I loved it, you know, done is better than perfect. So Kiva, how you been? Good to see you. So I really feel that way, you know, it's better to just get the drawings, the paintings under your belt. Don't worry if it's perfect. Just keep working and just keep improving, but definitely don't worry whether it's perfect or not, right? That's not important. So as you can see, right here, everything is lost. This is the only detail, right here. And everything around this eye is just black. But just that little detail is going to go a long way in creating depth to the form. And as you will see here, see that? That's really going to make a big difference. And then here we'll zoom out again. There we go. So you can see, you know, where I'm working from. Even here there's not much detail, but there is a lot of detail. See, there's no detail here, but there's just a little bit And I want to do that just to describe the form a little bit. Just give the drawing a little more character, so to speak. Maybe I'll zoom in just a little. There we go. Okay, let me zoom out just. Yeah, that's a little too close for me. I can zoom in a little bit. Let's see. Oh, I like that, right? That's not too bad. So let's see if we can focus that a little bit. See, when you have a zoom camera, what happens is that you lose the aperture, the opening of the lens goes down. That's why it's just a little bit darker. And I can combat that by raising the shutter speed a little bit. See, now we have a nice light picture. And I think we're gonna start going in with the airbrushing a little bit. Or if we don't, that's okay. I mean, the drawing is really crucial to me. That's like the most important aspect. If you don't get the drawing correct, it's not going to matter how the painting's gonna look. It's not gonna save it. And what I'm doing is establishing some of these really nice dark darks. And like right here, you can see that it comes up and then goes pretty far and pretty straight. So I definitely want to get that. See if I could change the angle of the light a little bit. Okay. See, it's a lot darker right there. And then right around here, it sort of lightens up. So you see that. So I don't really know who this is. I found this picture and it's really stunning the way way it was photographed, so I really enjoyed that. So I'm not sure who it is, but really like the lighting. Then right here, let's go down to her mouth here, and extend that out just a little bit. This is interesting. Now, the thing is, when you're working with pictures like this, with reference like this, you have some really nice shadows, but there's detail in those shadows. So you really want to make sure that you tackle that. That's very important. So, you know, right here we have some shadows. So it looks like we're doing a drawing, but we're not. We're prepping the airbrush. We're prepping the India ink. And as we work in the India ink, all these pencil lines are going to be erased. There's going to be no hint of pencil in the work. And they really don't go together, so you want to erase the pencil because pencil is shiny, India ink is matte, so they won't work together. So let's go back. Okay. So I love here that her lip is visible right here. See that? And then the rest is in shadow. Thank you, Jake. I appreciate that, man. You know what? It's always going to show how much I love drawing. That's the beauty of everything. So am I still on Facebook, Wendy? this is the softest of the soft here, which is really nice. Oh, thanks. This is a really cool view. I forgot that there's an 18 to, this is a 10 to 18 lens on my Canon. So I can zoom just a little bit. So I can, you know, zoom out and zoom in, which is pretty cool. I might, one of these days, if I can find a really good 18 to 55. Hey, Robert, good to see you, man. Thank you so much for stopping by. How's work going, Robert? And as you can see, there's really important contour lines here. So I really need to concentrate on that. Now, here, always take note of where those lines disappear. And you can see right here, they sort of disappear. It's kind of looking like a Vermeer in a sense, you know, this pose. So I do like, I think that's what really strikes me. So that's, so Rob, you're gonna be amazed, Robert, that I'm actually not on Facebook. With my software, which is XSplit, it shows that I'm not connected to Facebook. So that's quite bizarre. So the cat is, she's over there, and she hasn't jumped on the drawing table yet, so that's good. Let's see here. Okay, so you see, this is great because I don't have to get too detailed. I'm just setting up some landmarks here. But I do see that this angle, see right here, this angle is sort of, I would say maybe between 9 and 10 o'clock, right? So I'm looking at this and the angle is correct. So those are things I do. Yeah, the ghost cast. This will be known as the ghost cast, the great ghost cast of 2018. I should check and see if I'm on Twitch. Maybe I'm there accidentally as well. That would be cool. So this right here is all soft. And then right here. So there's a lot of subtlety in here, which is going to be great to capture. And the airbrush is great for subtlety. The best tool when it comes to that. So as you can see, we are getting pretty good as far as our contours and what we want. So you guys hear the cat? She's meowing somewhere. She's around here. And then here we have a beautiful contour. So let's not blow that. Let's make sure we have our act together when it comes to this contour. Yeah, the airbrush is, oh, you do hear her, huh, Wendy? Where is she? She's lurking about somewhere. She's gonna jump on the table when I least expect it. So, whoop, one moment. Okay. So far so good. I may have to shut the table again to keep the kitty out, and let's see if we're gonna get the lag again. But I'm pretty happy with the contours. What I was thinking of doing is making another drawing projection the exact same size and using that, you know, as a freehand shield. But that's almost impossible because what happens is that my contours are really, really succinct, very individual. So to use anything as a freehand shield like that would be impossible. That's for sure. Yeah, she's been very needy lately, the little kitten. So I'm happy with that. The ear looks pretty good. I can definitely come in later with the detail. And then, because I don't really want to work out a lot of the subtleties with the airbrush if I can do it right now with the pencil, right? So let's make sure we tackle all those things. And then right here on her shoulder, which is a very expressive part of this pose, we are going to try and capture this beautiful line. And when you do the line yourself, your handwriting comes out. And that's really important. I was at the Museum of Metropolitan, the Metropolitan Museum of Art last week, and I'll tell you, the biggest revelation was that the most important artworks were not perfect. That they had more of the signature of the artist and less worrying about how real it looks. The realism happens on its own, but the most important work, it had personality and life into it because the personality and life of not only the sitter but the artist was very evident. So I do like that. And right here, let's work on this beautiful contour here. And let's see if we could really get that. So we were going to work on this contour here. Really get the sort of the calligraphy of that. Oh yeah, basically what happened, Wendy, is once in, maybe once or twice in a live stream, the chat part goes away. But we keep the connection to YouTube. See how much more beautiful that is, that beautiful calligraphy in the line. Go. Same thing here. Really try and, oh, thank you, Wendy. Really try and accentuate sometimes the line. If it's more beautiful, it's okay to do that. It's like the difference between, let's say, an L, a regular L. It's the difference between an L and a, you know, a cursive L, a capital cursive L. It just has much more beauty to it. And if you can do that and get away with it just a little bit, that life I was talking, that life force that you see in the works of the great masters, that those are the things that make the the individual painting just stand out. And then I was telling Wendy about Monday's trip and also Jacob. It's not the artists who painted the best at the time who are most famous, but are the artists who are the innovators and who went their own way and solved their own problems, own particular problems when it comes to their artwork. And that, those guys and girls are the ones who are remembered. Case in point, we have Caravaggio, and Caravaggio is a great painter. He was an innovator. He was the first one to do the really strong lights and darks, and he used mirrors to draw the figures, and just the way that he worked was totally revolutionary. With that being said, there were artists who came after him, slightly after him. And one of the artists would be Giuseppe de Ribera. So if you look at Giuseppe de Ribera, his work actually looks better. It's actually a more advanced version of Caravaggio. Yet, now Ribera is a great artist, but Caravaggio is the innovator. So that's why there's so many more art books on Caravaggio, stories and movies written about him, because he was the innovator. There's hardly anything on Giuseppe Ribera, because he wasn't the innovator. He was the follower. So even today with airbrush, there's a lot of following going on. But no matter how good you are following, you're not going to be remembered. So yes, get the inspiration, get as much information you can from your favorite airbrush artists. But if you don't go your own way, you're just going to be a footnote. So definitely take it. And just like what you get from me, take the information from me, but go your own direction. That's what I'm hoping you do. I want you guys to reach your potential and get the attention that you deserve. So always try to innovate whenever you can. Does that make sense, guys? I hope so. But that's my commentary on my trip to the Metropolitan Museum of Art here in the city. Oh, you're welcome. Thank you, Wendy. That's a really important lesson that I learned from me. That, you know, I want to make my own mark. So I don't want to be a follower. I studied with some really amazing artists, and I know a lot of people continued going the route of my mentor, Harvey Dinnerstein. And they're doing great, but I also feel that maybe they should have taken it their own level. Thank you, Willie. I really, really, really appreciate that. They really should have went their own level because, you know, you might have quick success, right? And some success, you know, being a disciple of an artist, but you're not going to find your own voice. You're going to be a continuation of your mentor's voice. No one's going to see the world through your eyes. Only you are. I guess that's a great thing about painting and drawing. We get to have someone look at the world through our own eyes. So I really am thinking that, okay, we have a really nice drawing going on here, and maybe we can go ahead and tentatively begin some airbrushing. But I'm just going to be a little weary just for a little while longer, especially here, because that could mess up a bit. So we'll just zoom in there. Let's make sure that this contour is beautiful. Now, this is my tendency. My tendency is to make nostrils small and noses small. I don't know why, but that's my own thing. I think it's because I do have small nostrils. They say that when we paint people, we're basically doing a self-portrait. So I just want to make sure that I'm really getting what's happening here with her nose. So it goes down, shoots over, and goes down. There we go. I am still not sure about that. So we'll revisit that. That is a point of worry for me. So I usually do not go forward unless that is resolved. And then you just look for clues in different parts of the portrait. And still worrying about whether or not I'm making her nostrils too small. Those are things that I worry about. Now, do you guys have any problems that you, or just like these weird mannerisms when you paint portraits, do you make the eyes too big or the head too large? Anything like that that you always have to be weary of? Sort of shoots down here, comes up and over. I'm kind of happy with that, but gotta make sure that we got that nostril correct. And then sort of shoots up into the nostril there. There we go. Let's look at this different angle here. It's so true, right, Willie? If we could make, and that's the great thing about being a visual artist, we're letting someone see through our own eyes. Modern technology can't do that. Even what I said earlier, where, you know, maybe, you know, we see things differently. We make nostrils smaller, or, you know, or the heads are bigger in proportion to the body. So we're actually letting people know the way we see the world. Okay, so I am happy with this. I'm just going to indicate very lightly this shadow plane here. Okay, so let's look at this together here. Let me get that eraser. And then right over here is half shadow plane. And that's sort of connects right here. Thanks, Wendy. Yeah, this is definitely a challenge. Challenge accepted, right? But I'm thinking we're doing okay. So we will continue to watch that nose to make sure that I make it as big as it should be. Now we're going to work on this nostril here, and we're going to make sure that I don't make that nostril too small. Now keep in mind, this is going to be a very light value here. But this is just a sort of mapping outline, a mapping out line. Same thing with here. I'm just gonna indicate how her cheek comes in, you know, what angle here. So when we come in with the airbrush, we're gonna have a good idea. As you can see, I spend a lot of time with the drawing. So once the drawing aspect's over, it's over. You have to live with it. Glare here. And then different areas of the nostril will definitely give you clues as where other things should be, like a pieces of the puzzle. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to just gradually lighten things up. We're going to lose a lot of that contour, but it's just I need to get that anatomy correct, right? That's the essence of the model. Interesting, yes, these are FLEDs in here, and as you can see, it's soft but not too soft, hard but not too soft. It's right in the middle. It's just, I don't know, it just feels right to me, Wendy, you know? So I always recommend FLEDs because it just is the closest thing as an all-purpose pencil. And then we're always looking at our shapes because we're not coming in. When we come in with the airbrush, we pretty much have all the shapes pretty much mapped out. Oh, nice. So you did get the FLEDs. So cool. Yes, you're gonna love them. They are really good. You just get a good feel for, you know, that ability to, you know, make a nice mark, but not something that actually damages the paper. I think anything harder than an F or even an HB is the hardest I would go for all that. Oh yeah, so when you get them, they're gonna be great. HB is definitely the hardest you want to go, when you're drawing for a painting. That's for sure. But as you can see, just because I did initial projection doesn't mean that there's no drawing to be done. There's actually a lot of drawing to be done. And you have to draw. So always sketch, you know, always have a small sketchbook in your hand. Sketch when you're at the doctor's office, sketch people on the subways or the bus. Do a lot of freehand sketching. That is going to pay dividends. Dividends in your artwork, dividends in you seeing the angles. But have an aesthetic criteria. Work, do your best. But afterwards, always say, did I get that angle correct? Is the proportions correct? All those different things. You have to be your art teacher at all times when you don't have an art teacher. You know, you have to be the one who's going to say, uh-oh, I kind of blew it with that. But you can do that after the fact, right? It doesn't have to be perfect. You could say to yourself, okay, I'm going to be mindful not to do that again. So right here is very interesting. So we have her lips coming down here, then sort of stops right here. Then we see the bottom lip sort of come out sort of like at this angle. And like I said, a lot of things that I do, I have a proclivity to do is also to make the lips not as full as they are. One of the things that is separating the bottom lip from, let's say, the dark of her cheek is this little bit of light coming out. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just going to indicate that bit of light. So when I do come in with the airbrush, that I hit that and I'm able to see that light, because that light's gonna really make a big difference. And while I can, you know, I can definitely hit that when I'm doing the airbrush part, oh no, Lisa, I hope that gets better. I'm so sorry about that. That's, I think Wendy was saying that all of the internet is having issues today. So that stinks. Then I really want to make sure that I'm getting the size of this dark here. So it's very important that I get the general measurements and the grace of the line. And a projection is going to help me with composition. It's going to help me with placement on the paper. As you can see, I have her off to the side and not in the center. Sort of have a really nice sort of C here, shape. So that's why I did that. And then here, I didn't project that, but there's a really nice, where her cheek is. There's an interesting dark here. Now we'll find that I'll use, some of the white pastel to fill in this area, and this is just the this might even be just a little darker than the value of the paper. So I want to use the value of the paper. That's very important. All right, man, talk to you tomorrow. Jake, thanks for stopping by. Good to see you, bud. can see I'm really concentrating on the anatomy of her, you know, where her lips go, everything like that. Now it looks like, this is always interesting, it looks like her lips are turning up, but they really aren't. What it is this shadow caused by the indentation of the lips sort of goes up, but her lips themselves are pretty straight down. So that's interesting. Same here, let's go up here and see if we can work out where those eyebrows are in the darkness. Like I said, it's so much easier to go ahead and draw it out with the pencil than be dealing with such subtleties with an airbrush. Even though I'm getting better with the airbrush, I'll never be as good in any other tool as I am with the pencil, because I've been working with pencil since I was a little boy, and you guys too. That's how you started out with the pencil. That's what you're gonna feel most comfortable with. So do the hardest stuff with the material that you're most confident and comfortable with. And that makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? It's like I remember when I was in high school and it was a painting class. I went to the High School of Art and Design, pretty advanced painting class. And they said, oh, we want you to draw using the paintbrush. I'm like, okay, I did it. And the drawings were crude, not just for me, but for everyone, because you're using a big old paintbrush. So tell me, if you're using a paintbrush to draw, how much is it easier to use this to draw? So my opinion is, whatever does a better job, that's what I want to use. So I don't agree with, you know, having artists draw with the paintbrush, because that's not what is most comfortable. Now that's not the same as, let's say, you know, I want you to go outside your comfort zone. No, that's different. But to actually do something, an aspect of your painting, it's something you don't feel 100% comfortable with, how is that better? If it doesn't hurt the final, you know, the final result of the piece, how is that better? So this right here is a webcam, and then this right here is my DSLR, my Canon SL2, which is cool. And then, you know, I have this, I have different lenses for, you know, seeing myself, but I kind of like the idea that we can go from different views. So I'm working on a large pastel painting right now. It's 24 by 36. That's large for my standards. And in the picture, she has on a down jacket. And that is very difficult. So I am not going in with color until I resolve that down jacket with pencil, because that's what I feel most comfortable to handle something like that. A lot of buttons and zippers and puffiness and weird folds. So yeah, that's something I definitely want to take care of before I go in with color. Thank you, Wendy. That's so cool, because I think the different views really help out. And I want to Because the lighting is really weird. You know, with drawings, you have a lot of glare. So I have a couple of the cameras, and I'm not sure where I'm going to put them just to get, like, you know, just a feeling of where I am in space so you guys really feel like you're at a demonstration. I went to a lot of demonstrations at the Art Students League and the National Academy School of Fine Arts in New York City, and I've given a lot of demonstrations. And the best part of demonstration is you're right there over the shoulder of the artist working. And that's what I want my live streams and my videos to be like. So I'm gonna hopefully start doing those instructional videos, and they're gonna be full-length videos going over the pastel palette method, and also full-length videos on airbrush and drawing. So they're gonna be very informative, and they're gonna be exciting. So as you can see, I'm feeling pretty good right now. Let's go ahead and work on some of the larger shapes of the hair. Hair is usually comprised of large shapes. So I just want to indicate some of those shapes in pencil, so when I come in with airbrush, it's not so alien to me. And the great thing about this technique, I could erase, so I have a lot of wiggle room. But before I go in, I always want to make sure I have a good game plan. And just like the gesture of a model, you want to get the gesture of her hair. Make sure things are not too dark. So this is a really good lesson tonight. Basically, when you are doing using things such as projectors or the grid method, or even when you sort of some people put charcoal on the back and then put it over and then go over it with a ballpoint pen or something, and then you sort of transfer the image. So even if you use a device of some sort to transfer the image, it doesn't mean you can just go right into painting. You really want to make the drawing your own. So take your time and look at it and make sure that the airbrush is the best tool to solve whatever you're working on, whatever question you have. So that's why take care of whatever needs to be taken care of with the pencil first. See, I would have missed this beautiful line here, this beautiful contour. So I'm glad that I spend more time. And you know, my thing is, you know, part of me wants to just go ahead and go in with the airbrush right away, like, yay, this is gonna be great. But there's time. But I do see that, as you can tell, just making these little changes does help with the expression. Like I said, where things look a little dark, lighten them up. So, there are some things going on with her chin here. So we definitely want to tackle that a little bit. So there's a darkest dark here. And then we have this beautiful contour of her neck coming right here. But I can see that the dark doesn't lift up till past the contour of her neck, and then comes right like over here. So just paying attention to that is going to make a big difference. And then it's dark and disappears. Now there's a mid-tone that comes over here, and then we can pretty much figure out where that mid-tone stops by getting clues elsewhere. And all these indication lines are going to go away when we go over it with India ink. So those are just mapping out what's going to happen here. And it may look a little weird, but that's okay. Final product. Think we're getting pretty close to the ability to come in with the airbrush. Let's see here. We'll go with this different angle. So far, so good. Kind of liking it. I'm in much better shape now than when I was when I started. So let me quickly get another one of these cups. This one is dirty, so hold on one moment. So these are really great. They are, I think they're by Diamond. You get them at Walmart. Walmart brand even has them. You get like 50 of them for like $2.50. They work great for acrylic, for ink, They even come with tops. Rarely do I ever need to use the paint again. It's always good to mix it once again, so that's cool. So let's go ahead and mix some paint together here. Actually, ink together. So I'm gonna put this over here. Okay. Let's see if this bad boy will, okay, cool. So remember, we're gonna do 3 and 3. I just wanna make sure. I have a chart that I made years ago that I always use. So here's my chart. And with my chart, I have what I would use, how many eyedroppers of ink, how many drops of ink to eyedroppers of water. So you can see I have all these different values. I usually start with around this value, which is 3 full eyedroppers of water and 2 drops of ink. I was gonna do 3 and 3, but I think that's a little dark. I like this one. So we're gonna do 3 full eyedroppers of water to 2. So what we'll do is we'll double the ratio. So I'll do 6 eyedroppers of water and 4 drops of ink. I like doing the water first. So I have my water here, so you guys can see. This is a very crucial part of this process. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Just a little bit. Okay, so that's 9. So I'm doing 3 times the ratio. So that's 9. So 3 and 2. So 3 times 3 is 9. 3 times 2 is 6. So that means 6 eyedroppers of the India ink. I use Higgins Waterproof India ink. So I'm going to take my water and put that aside. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay. And that's where we're at. And we're going to close it up. The cat just opened the door. Here she is. Take a little bit of a hair or something. Okay, I did get that. Okay, so I have a nice mixture. And I can just go ahead and mix this really well. Now, normally I would never mix ink or paint anywhere near my artwork. But this is just to show you guys. Let me go wipe this off. Always have paper towels close by. Paper towels and wipes, baby wipes. Those are crucial. Okay, any questions about the mixture? So what I'm gonna do, we're gonna work with this Eclipse, the CM-C+. I did work on it. It might have a problem, but we'll try it. I think it was working correctly. So let's see. Let's fire this up. I'm gonna connect it to my compressor. And I don't wanna work too late. We're just gonna start. Go ahead and load up the airbrush here. Okay, so we'll put the ink over here. And since we have this test paper here, let's go ahead and do a quick test. One of the things I look for is it like, I have the air down all the time, but when I push down the trigger, get the ink, when I stop, I don't want to see any trailing. And it is looking pretty good. Now it's very light. I'm not gonna be able to get too detailed when it's this light, but we're just gonna do some light covering. Get a larger area here. So, like I said, we're going to definitely be erasing some of these hard pencil lines. Now, the good thing is I do have some freehand shields in here. Let's utilize those bad boys. So, I love it when the custom microns are working. But I hate them when they don't. And anyone who's been working airbrush for a while knows that they have their share of times when they're not working correctly. So I just want to really establish that really beautiful hard edge of the ear. Notice how far away I am. And notice, since I am working on paper, I don't oversaturate the surface. A lot less than if I was working on wood. Keeping my eye on the cat over there. Oh, Wendy, when they don't, when they don't, I don't like the custom microns. They're temperamental. So right now what I'm going to do, guys, is I'm working on the large shapes. And look how far away I am. I'm a good, I would say, about 4 inches from the surface. But Wendy, when the custom microns are working, it's like, it's like driving a sports car. It's really great. And when they're working correctly, they're the best airbrushes you're ever going to use. So, you know, even though I have a love-hate relationship with them, they're still the best. My Eclipse is in the other room. That's my airbrush of choice. See how I'm getting this really beautiful edge now? And I'm gonna erase the pencil line soon. Okay. They do crash, yes. And you do gotta take them to a very expensive mechanic when they break down. So you're right. And let's go ahead and do some erasing while we're working on these large shapes. So you guys can see how I am setting up. How I set up with the pencil, with the projection in the pencil to work on the airbrush. We don't go straight in. You know, this is probably the best surface I ever worked on. Next to the Masonite, of course. But to have this wonderful gray, oh, it's so nice. Well, hold this paper down. See, the one thing with this particular, this is the CM-C Plus, and this particular airbrush is a Micron. It's my first Micron I ever purchased. And what I think is I have to do is there's probably something stuck in the actual nozzle itself, because when I push it down, I get a little bit of ink. So that's something that, when you're early going, it's fine. I could live with that. But after I clean this, I'm gonna actually, yes, this is the Micron, definitely. This is the CM-C Plus, which is the gravity feed. And you see how I make sure as I crawl the contours. So I'm just really just hitting the contours where I have the freehand shield covering the background. See that? And I'm going to do the same up here. And the trick is to take your time and find those contours. Now we might have to, definitely take our time. As well, thank you. Thank you so much. And the great thing about this Micron, as you can see here, that, let me see if I could get that. As you can see here, this Micron has the MAC valve right here, so I can adjust the air, and I could, lower the air pressure if I want, and that helps for control. Especially in very sensitive areas, such as these contours. Whoa. And as I'm going with those contours, I can go ahead and erase the pencil lines. So what I'm left is just some beautiful ink passages. Yeah, those MAC valves are the best. You're very welcome. They are make your life so much easier. I don't see how anyone would have time to adjust the air at the compressor. And of course, I'm going to get much darker here. And as you can see, we are taking our time. There's no rush. And there are times when you need a freehand shield, and there are times when you don't. Right here, it's a very soft edge on the bridge of her nose, going into her eye socket. It's very soft, so we're not going to be worrying about freehand shields and getting really hard edges. This angle, you can probably see a little better where I'm going. Remember, don't oversaturate the surface.